Welcome back, everyone, to the AWS studio here in Mobile World Congress, Barcelona. I'm with Fawad and Guy from Snowflake and AWS, respectively, and we're going to talk a little bit more about how telcos can utilize their data assets to unlock smart network operations using AI-enabled digital twins. Whole lot to talk about today, but let's start with a few intros. Over to you, Fawad.
Fawad Qureshi, industry field CTO at Snowflake, and my role is to help telcos make better decisions using data analytics.
Good stuff. Hi, Robert. I'm Baruch. I'm a leading solution architecture for data, AML, and GenAI in the telco business unit in AWS.
What I love about today is we get to recap all of the great work we did over the past year or so. The two of you actually were back here in the studio a year and change ago where we talked about the telecom data cloud. Can you tell me a little bit, maybe starting with you, Fawad, how does the work that you were doing with the telecom data cloud very much parlay into the work we're doing this year with smart network operations? Tell me about that journey.
The telecom data cloud at its core is provides the customers, partners, and the ecosystem of telecom to come together. And it provides that network effect. So a number of the, those companies, they are joining the telecom data cloud because their supply chain, their value chain exists in the telecom data cloud. So it feels like, oh, if I want to work with my supplier, this is what how I can make the most of that data that is coming out of my supplier. So let's be part of that that collaboration. Let's combine the data and let's build net new data products. And that creates that kind of cascade effect. And we show in our visualizations on how that that data cloud is expanding over the years. You know, it starts with a few customers, and then they start adding their value chain, and it starts value chain. It's basically that network effect. And that has grown quite a lot in the last year or so. And now across multiple industries, the data cloud is now up to 9,000 customers.
Wow, 9,000 customers. So you must have this rich customer feedback telling you how you can evolve and build atop this critical data platform. So Guy, from your perspective, what are you hearing from customers around? You have that baseline telecom data cloud. They want to harvest rich insights through the likes of generative AI. What were you hearing and how did that evolve your sort of decision making this year as you built out these the smart network operations portfolio?
Mm-hmm. So I think what is really important for customers is actually that type of seamless integration between, for example, the telecom data cloud perspective from a Snowflake side. How can we integrate that from the generative AI stack which lives on the AWS side? And this is exactly also what we are showing for that type of solution, how customers can host data on the telecom data cloud side on Snowflake and basically integrate the data that they have there, whether it will be data coming from the data marketplace or real-time data that we're looking in the context of the digital twin, to get meaningful insights when you host those large language models on the AWS side.
And then from your perspective, Fawad, with customers from all different industries asking you about the opportunities to leverage these rich insights from the telecom data cloud, how did that lend itself to building out this this digital twin?
There's a very interesting insight that came out of the recap of the last Mobile World Congress. Last year, there were 88,500 attendees in this conference. 56% of those attendees came from outside the telecom ecosystem. Those retailers, supply chain, logistics partners, and why were they here? They want to build partnership with the telecom ecosystem. Because the telecom industry has unbounded access to the consumer data, and that location insight is gold. So what we thought about in this particular solution that we are demoing this week is how can we take that telecom data and power other industries? We took airport as an example, but that use case could be deployed in manufacturing shop floors. You could do it in the retail stores, any big shopping mall. You can think about stadium concerts, whatever big events. And we can provide that kind of private 5G experience using digital twin and GenAI.
So I don't have a stable diffusion on me, but if you were to paint a picture, Guy, of what we would see if we were on the show floor right now with that huge 6-foot LED touchscreen, fully horizontal, what does that experience look like for customer and partners? Walk us through it.
So I think if we think about that solution end to end, it's quite different compared to what people usually see in those type of demos. And I think the combination here with generative AI together with digital twin capabilities and what we used to implement that called the AWS IoT Twinmaker, and the ability from a network operations perspective, you know, a networking operation guy is looking at the demo and is having the ability to communicate with a chat bot, but not only via, you know, like a Q&A type of a discussion, but actually becoming proactive from a simulation and turning on different cells in the airport, so you can ask questions to the chatbot, for example, to simulate how the traffic will look next week when there's going to be a major event in the airport, right? And the next question might be, or you can actually activate the chatbot to say, you know, can you please summarize what are the key issues that might arise when, you know, there will be incoming traffic and so on? Can you simulate traffic? And then immediately on that big screen, you can see how that is impacting the digital twin, right? So you might have a new cell now turning on and becoming green. You might have another cell with an exclamation mark saying, you know, that there is some impact in terms of a KPI reduction and so on. So I think it's a very unique experience for someone who's, you know, experiencing that in the show.
So you have these heterogeneous data sources, network telemetry, mapping data, location data. How does the flexibility of Snowflake and interoperability really bring this to life, Fawad?
One of the key principles of Snowflake architecture is that we will always bring the processing to the data rather than shipping the data over to the processing. We have a lot of customers in the telecom domain, you know, their network data on a daily basis is more than a petabyte per day. I mean, there is absolutely no way you can ship that data over to any other thing because that network will simply not work at that scale. So what Snowflake is doing is bringing that all types of processing closer to the data, whether it is AI, ML, Gen AI, all of that closer to the data in the security parameter of the customer so that they don't have to worry about any kind of data leakage or any of those concerns. Right? Your data remains private, your metadata remains private, your Gen AI model remains private, and your prompts remain private as well. And that's the security and governance, and you get the maximum time to market benefit out of that solution.
Maybe let's put on our solution architect hat here for a second, Guy. I do want to ask, as you think about the breadth and depth of AWS generative AI services and tools, Amazon Bedrock was selected for this particular showcase that you see on the show floor. How did you select Amazon Bedrock, and what are the key values of Bedrock that really helped bring this showcase to life?
I think what was interesting for us is, first of all, the integration between Bedrock and Snowflake, right? So the ability to trigger Bedrock, choosing an LLM and Bedrock, in that case we were using the Claude large language model that is hosted on Bedrock. So we integrated from Snowflake, you have a chatbot, whenever you're asking a question, it goes back to Bedrock. But I think what is more exciting is the concept of Bedrock agents, right? So it's not only about, you know, a Q&A conversation with the chatbot, it's also about defining agents. We defined agents that Bedrock can then go and select, like a toolbox, and those agents can then go and simulate 2x traffic. They can go and open a ticket for engineering. They can do all kinds of activities. And then it's not only about, you know, we have an LLM which is sitting there, we can ask questions, but it's about actually start building applications end to end, right? So we build a complete network operation application which is using agents to then go and ask questions and query Snowflake databases, but also go and execute and do other things as well.
And I think that end-to-end solution is really redefining what that telco LLM can even mean. It's a whole application. It's not just one ingredient.
Exactly.
So as you think about Snowflake's strategy, Fawad, from your perspective, how are these solutions playing a role and how you map those customer signals to industry solutions that you're building?
There was something interesting that happened yesterday when I was coming over to MWC Barcelona at Heathrow Airport. I had some 5G connectivity issues, so my data plan was not working fine, so I tried to connect to the Heathrow Wi-Fi. And immediately I get an error, too many connections, cannot connect to the Wi-Fi. And I was like, how interesting is this? You know, we are building a solution for this private 5G, and this is how we are going to build. The way we see this in much broader context is, I was discussing with somebody on LinkedIn yesterday, there are 5 generations of programming languages. I started my career many years ago writing assembly language code, machine code, writing the really low-level stuff. And now we see a lot of the programmers, data scientists across the world writing Python, which is 4th generation language. There are 5th generation languages like Prolog and Mercury, which even make it simpler. The way I see all these technologies, Gen AI and digital twins, is they are democratizing different complex data analytics tasks The reason why you want to bring them in is so that the average user who is the domain expert, but not necessarily a software programmer, can still interact with the system and make better informed decisions. This is the point. So I would possibly call this the sixth generation languages. I don't know if that term exists, but maybe I could copyright that, right? So that could be my 6GL languages. And that is something that we see is going to introduce. And that's why we see, and there are going to be a lot more co-pilots, different type of solution that would be aided by such kind of augmentation technologies. But the thing that we see this kind of technology across the ecosystem is they are going to be co-pilots, not autopilots. Right, so you'll let that co-pilot drive that plane, but you'll not let it land the plane, and that's the kind of thing. So you want to think about where there is a need for human in the loop, we'll get that, and any kind of mundane activities that are required that will be automated by technologies such as GenAI and digital twins.
So to realize that notion of that co-pilot, there's such a tremendous need for enablement, for upskilling, inspiring, and empowering that next generation of builders and business decision makers to really harness this full capability, not only of generative AI, but the underlying data sources. So maybe to dive a little bit deeper into that, to each of you, starting with you, Guy, what's one misconception, either about the solution developed or about this convergence of disparate data sources that you want to debunk here to the audience?
So I think talking to customers, especially in the telco industry, but also in enterprise, bigger enterprises, is the concept of data silos, right? And I think one of the unique things that we've seen, for example, in this solution, but in general in the context of generative AI, is, as Fawad also mentioned before, it doesn't matter where the data resides, right? Because from a large model perspective, we can connect to data sources without moving the data around and then start asking questions and generating insights on that. And the other additional thing and advantage is that, business stakeholders, for example, they can ask a question in plain English. That question will be translated into a complex SQL without understanding the schema of how the data resides in Snowflake and get back the results. So one, the fact that the data can reside anywhere in data silos, and the other thing is it doesn't really matter now, the type of schema, the type of database, you're just asking a plain English SQL, plain English question that will be translated into SQL.
Just I'll add something on top of it. While yes, the tool can reach out to those schemas and connect to it, one of the things that is missing in a lot of large enterprise systems today is most of the systems are built for human to machine connectivity. They're not built for machine to machine connectivity. What do I mean by that? There's three types of metadata. There's technical metadata, the column names and column types. There's operational metadata, logs, and all the kind of things. The most important thing is the business metadata. I have this column. What does this column mean? I want that system to understand what is contained in that information. And I was working with a very large logistics company a few years back, and I had to run a hackathon there. And on the day of the hackathon, we started working on the system, and the person who knew all the business glossary in their head, they fell sick. They were not available. So for 8 hours during the hackathon, we could not find the customer address or location column in that supply chain database because it had 50,000 tables. Each table had 20 columns. We had 1 million columns, and we could not find, and we were looking through all the dictionary and could not find out. The next day, the guy comes back and says, oh, it's obvious. The column was called CU underscore AD. So, and I'm like, how is that obvious? You took an abbreviation and all. So when a human could not find customer address column, which was CU underscore AD, what chance does a Gen AI model, which is prone to hallucination, have to understand that system? So what we need to think about building such kind of enterprise systems is, how do we build that business glossary, business metadata, so that a machine could understand and connect to that machine, which is that data system? Because all that documentation which is residing in the head of the people, which is a massive technical debt for large organizations, this is what organizations need to think about, and think about services like AWS Glue and putting that data into those services so that data could be understood by these machine systems.
I think that's a fantastic anecdote. And if I could reference some material you highlighted last year, you mentioned that you can use data to transform digital exhaust into digital fuel. So as we look ahead, what's your vision for digital fuel over the coming months in 2024? What are you most excited to see? And then I'll let you, Guy, have the final word.
I mean, just look at this solution, this airport digital twin solution. It is powered by all the logs that are being generated across the entire private 5G network. What we are doing is capture all those logs and all the different kind of remote sensing data. You know, we are getting flight information. We are finding out whether Taylor Swift has a concert in this place or not, and all those footfalls. Based on all of that information is all around us. All we have done in the solution is put that together into a single system, connect it to a technology, make it useful, make it consumable, so that the average non-technical person can interact with that. And that is really the fuel for taking this solution to the next level. So if there is a spike, you know, just like what I faced at Heathrow yesterday, I could still connect to a Wi-Fi. That's what we could enable through this solution.
Mm-hmm. So just to summarize from my perspective, you know, when we think about the generative AI era about a year ago when everything started and so on, people were looking on generative AI only in the context of a chatbot. This is how they interact with the model and so on. And we were really trying to think together with customers what type of telco use cases can be leveraged by generative AI. And then we started to think about customer care, customer experience, network operation and so on. And what we're seeing now with network operation, what we've built together is that how you can make recommendations from network operation teams and so on. But I think the next evolution of that, like you're saying, the fuel for that, the catalyst will be how can we start being proactive on the network, right? So it's not only about, hey, you know, I have issue X, Y, and Z, but the model behind the scenes using those agents can then go and do proactive activities, right? So I think it's about trying to see how we can automate the whole workflow, and those models can help us become, you know, more proactive on the network as well.
Absolutely. I think what a great showcase, what a great partnership, and thank you so much for being part of our AWS studio.